Dr. Ehrlich, when did the thought first come to you that perhaps our time as mankind on Earth was limited?
Oh, it came in 1949 when I read a book by William Vogt called Road to Survival. And it was a subject of a lot of bull sessions. That was when I was a freshman at the University of Pennsylvania. We had a lot of bull sessions in that area. Then I went into population biology professionally. I did graduate work in entomology at the University of Kansas. And my first assistantship when I first arrived was working on the development of resistance to DDT in fruit flies. And I got involved in the late 50s in attempts to move us out of our ecologically insane agricultural practices, fighting with the Department of Agriculture on what they were doing and so on. Talking about that, I think all ecologists got very, very concerned in the 50s when they saw particularly the pesticide situation developing and so on. And I did a lot of talking to students about this, of course, at Stanford in my courses, and they talked to their parents. I got invited to alumni conferences, and one day I was invited someplace where there's a TV camera, and things have gone downhill from there on. So I think a lot of people think this is something new, but biologists have been scared essentially since the end of the Second World War, and increasingly more so as time has gone on. Rachel Carson first brought the beginnings of the crisis to the public attention in 1962, and now
she was literally crucified at the time.
Well, that's because entomologists, and this is my own profession, are largely incompetent. They're badly trained and so on. A lot of them are essentially paid hired hands of the petrochemical industry, which has a vested interest in keeping up a program which doesn't benefit farmers, consumers, or the economy, but it benefits the industry. And so a lot of them simply essentially took money to abuse her when she was not only right, she was conservative. It's interesting that they only abused her. Robert Rudd wrote a much more scientific book at the same time, coming to the same conclusions. They didn't pay any attention to him. They were only concerned that the public might get excited about being poisoned and having the planet destroyed. So she suffered. She had cancer. She was unmercifully abused. She eventually died, I think probably a little early because of the abuse she took. But if we survive the coming crisis, no small part of the credit will go to her. She's the one who sort of opened the gates to public interest in this area.
Your main concern has been the population bomb, as you call it in your book. Do you feel that this takes precedence over any other type of pollution, and certainly human pollution?
It takes precedence in the following sense. The reason I named the book The Population Bomb was in 1968, when I wrote it, everybody was getting concerned about pollution, but people hadn't seen the other element. I thought the emphasis ought to go there. The thing that's important to remember about population control is that if we want to avoid a tremendous rise in the death rate, we absolutely must have a tremendous decrease in the birth rate. Now, because the world's population is so young, it means that even if we got a tremendous decrease in the birth rate, if the average family completed family size immediately moved down to the vicinity of 2, we would still face 40 or 50 years of rapid population growth. There's a tremendous lag time built into it because those young people, the 40% of the people in the world that are under 15, are going to have children and grandchildren before they get old enough to die of old age. So we have this tremendous built-in lag time, which means that we've got to start instantly on population control only because we know it'll take so long. We also have to start instantly on all the cleaning up of the environment, changing our resource policies and so on at the same time. So it's not a matter of starting one before the other. If you only had 50 million people in the United States and the petrochemical industry had its way, we'd all end up dead. In the same time, if we cleaned up the environment as best as we could and kept the population growing, we'd all end up dead. So it's not one or the other. It's got to be both at the same time.
But educational processes are so slow. Can we reach people soon enough?
We've got to use political processes. I don't think you can. You don't have to educate everyone in the United States. Only Mr. Nixon and Mr. Agnew can listen to the silent and understand what they're saying. What you need is to get about 10 million people really concerned with taking action to solve these problems and work through the political system, and you'll be able to get the job done. You don't need everybody. You need a concerned activist group that's willing to do something. Most people in the United States don't pay any attention to politics or what's going on, and you don't need them.
What hope is there?
Oh, there's the only hope that there is that we will be able, at least in the United States, through the political process, to get a government that's courageous enough to say, look, we're overpopulated and we have to have population control and start moving in that direction. And saying we in the world can no longer sustain a cowboy economy. We're 6% of the world's people. We now consume something like 30% of the natural resources of the world. That, of course, is why we're in Vietnam. We're down there because we're trying to get our share of one of the last large unoccupied resource pools in Southeast Asia. That's why our CIA's in South America. That's why our Middle East policy is what it is, because of oil. We can no longer behave this way. We've got to say that we're not going to judge the quality of life as being the number of tinny automobiles that we have passing through our hands and a different color refrigerator every year, we're going to have to start thinking about saving our lives, reducing our consumption of resources, thinking about the real quality of life instead of the gross national product. And it's going to take a very, very courageous group of politicians. We have some of them already, but they're not in positions of power. Governor of this state is one that I think might do a very good job in this area.
But now we hear so much about overpopulation in countries like India and South America. Is there not a real problem, perhaps a more real problem there than here?
Well, the problem in South America or in India is the growth rate's extremely fast, and this is going to lead to a tremendous amount of starvation there. So in that sense, it's a very serious problem there. But you've got to remember that in a sense, in another sense, in a more real sense, our growth rate is the most serious in the world. For instance, if you take per capita power consumption as your best measure of pollution, in other words, of your negative impact on the environment, each American baby born is 50 times the disaster for the world as each Indian baby. If you take per capita consumption of steel as your measure of consumption of the Earth's very small supply of non-renewable resources, each American baby is 300 times the disaster for the world as each Indonesian baby. Similarly, within the United States, there are a lot of people who seem to feel, well, the problem is too many poor babies or too many black babies. It's nonsense. It's the affluent and the well-to-do and the middle-class people who are doing the consuming and polluting. And it's really our problem to start controlling our population growth first. I mean the affluent whites in the United States and their equivalent in the Soviet Union, in Japan, and Western Europe, the overdeveloped countries.
As a trained entomologist, you speak out against the use of pesticides. What alternatives are there to keep up the quality of our produce?
Well, first of all, one of the great fallacies promoted by the industry is that the quantity of our produce is a product of pesticides, and that's nonsense. It's a product of agricultural advances made in the 30s before we used synthetic pesticides. Second of all, it isn't a question of getting rid of all pesticides. It's of getting rid of the hard pesticides, chlorinated hydrocarbons, and they should be banned instantly. If we could get the Department of Agribusiness to do something about it, it would be a great benefit. You can use soft pesticides in appropriate circumstances, but what you have to move to is what people call integrated control, and that is using a mix of methods that are appropriate to the situation. Above all, not using controls on insect populations unless the populations are there. One of the great things that the petrochemical industry has managed to do with the cooperation of the Department of Agribusiness in Washington is to convince farmers that they've got to spray on a calendar whether or not the pests are there. You see, this sells a lot of pesticides. It guarantees the pests will become resistant, which means you can sell more pesticides because the industry says, if they become resistant, just use more pesticide. You see, so it creates a system which guarantees the promotion of pesticides. It also guarantees that you'll develop more pests. In other words, it promotes non-pest species to pest status. So you have a business which creates more demand for itself and more targets for its own use. Now, it's beautiful. What it does is it costs farmers a lot of money. It gives us smaller agricultural productivity than we could have. It does support the Entomological Society of America because, of course, it's essentially bought by the petrochemical industry. If you look, here's a classic group of scientists who have sold their souls to industry. Open the front page of the bulletin of the Entomological Society of America and you will see the list of sustaining associates, essentially every petrochemical company in the United States. It's a small wonder that most applied entomologists, not all, there are some excellent ones who understand the situation, are quite happy to run around and damn Rachel Carson, ate DDT, in a state hearing in California. Nobody in the world argues that DDT is not immediately poisonous. Everybody knows it isn't. But to impress the public, he actually ate DDT. This is the sort of thing he can do for money.
Now, given the population explosion, let alone in this country, what ought the government to do about this?
Well, what it ought to do is this. The first thing, I'm against government interference in our lives. You want to minimize that. So the very first thing the government should do is try and take the pressure off to reproduce. There's a lot of pressure in our society now to reproduce. If you're single, people try and push you into getting married. You know, your wife, you have a bachelor over, and your wife says, gee, shouldn't I have a nice girl over? The idea is, you know, nobody should escape. So there's pressure to get married. Young couples, if they don't have children, people say, gee, they must be sterile. They never say, gee, maybe they like good wine and going to the theater and so on. They prefer that to scraping diapers. So there's pressure to have children. So the first thing that should happen is that the president ought to say, from now here on out, no intelligent, patriotic American family ought to have more than two children, preferably one, if you're starting a family now. Not any law, but just say, this is what responsible people do. He ought to make the FCC see to it that large families are always treated in a negative light on television wherever they appear. There ought to be a tremendous amount of television time devoted to spot commercials, the sort we've had against smoking. But the ones in the middle, say in the middle of Beverly Hillbillies, you get a scene which shows Los Angeles in the smog, and it just says, this city has a fatal disease. It's called overpopulation, and so long. Now, that sort of campaign, you could have a census, a sample census, which would see whether that was having a desired effect. If that didn't, you could move to giving women bonuses for not having babies. That almost certainly would do the job. If that didn't have the effect, then you could move to changing the tax structure so that people who had the money and had the children paid for the children. In other words, you would increase taxes on people with children rather than decrease them, since when they have the children, they require more services. If that doesn't work, then you'll have the government legislating the size of the family. And people say, oh, that's impossible. Government can never intrude and tell you how many children to have. Well, I got news. You know, it intruded a long time ago and told you how many wives you can have. And there's not the slightest question that if we don't get the population under control with voluntary means, that in the not-too-distant future, the government will simply tell you how many children you can have and throw you in jail if you have too many.
Unfortunately, you have said that time is not on our side, and what you just mentioned could take too long.
Well, let's put it this way. Time, in a sense, will be on our side as soon as we start moving. And the reason is this, that we're going to face disasters in the future because the gap between food and population is bound to grow. For instance, we've already released so much DDT into the environment that if not another single molecule was released, the peak runoff into the oceans wouldn't come for about a decade, and the peak deleterious effect in the oceans might be 20 or 30 years off. So there's going to be disasters. The question is, do the disasters happen in a context of the world trying to save itself and for people trying to help each other, trying to solve the problem, or do they come in the kind of context we have today with the overdeveloped nations stealing from the underdeveloped nations and the petrochemical industry trying to poison us for profit and so on and so forth? So you really have essentially won the game when you've decided to play it, or at least you've gone a long way towards that. In other words, you've decided to change your ways, change your reproductive behavior, change your economic behavior, and so on. Then you've immediately increased your chances tremendously.
What disasters do you see if we don't change our ways?
Well, we're losing 10 to 20 million people a year to starvation right now. That's a big disaster already, and that will inevitably increase.
Worldwide.
Oh, and in the United States, too. Mm-hmm. We are very close to a famine disaster in the United States because of the things that air pollution is doing to change the weather. We have entrained a series of weather changes, which now look like we may have a very serious, very large weather change in the United States, which, of course, will hurt our agriculture tremendously. So we're close to famine in the United States, too. We're very close to a worldwide plague that could kill virtually everybody we just missed in 1967. And this is something that concerns biologists a great deal. The denser, the larger, the weaker the population gets, the more we are set up for a virus that'll just run through, and it'll be so long for 3/4 of the people. And, of course, every person you add to the planet increases, and every bit of pollution you add also increases the chances of a thermonuclear war and makes its results worse, because the thermonuclear war, of course, would wreck the ecology in a way that we haven't managed with our little efforts so far. So that the disaster will take the form of famine, plague, or war. They're mankind's old companions, fundamentally. You just got to remember this. There's no way out of the arithmetic. There will never be 7 billion people in the year 2000. The only question is, why won't there be 7 billion people in the year 2000? Will it be because we've had so many people die off of those things, or will it be because we have managed to bring the birth rate down a long way?
I believe somewhere you have given 1972 as a point of no return.
Yeah, it's a point of no return because if we don't have a responsible government by then, we got to wait 4 more years before we can get one. And that's just too long to wait. In other words, because of all the lag times and so on, if we can't get moving in that direction in 1970 and get a president by 1972, then it's just hopeless. So my own feeling is that should be our watershed. If in 1972 things are still being run the same old way, then at least as far as I'm concerned, the ball game will be over. I got to point out that many of my colleagues think it's already over. I'm considered a pessimist by the public and an optimist by many of my colleagues. So,
and the future will tell if there is a future.
That's right.
Thank you, Dr. Ehrlich. I've been speaking with Dr. Paul R. Ehrlich, author of The Population Bomb.